Now, I know this morning that y'all just think in your mind and in your heart that I am wearing red and black in honor of the Razorbacks finally winning the game last night. But that's not why I'm wearing it. Yes, sir. And we have a number one team in the state somewhere. But anyway, let me say that my favorite number is now 17. Because Arkansas had lost 17 conference games in a row, but they beat LSU 17-0.
Yes.
So if you ever want to give me a number, give me a 17. Anyway, Exodus chapter 13, beginning with verse
17.
You're exactly right. Verse 17, and this was done before that victory. 17. It got 17 minutes. Woo! I'm going to let Brother Lee preach for me. Then it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest perhaps the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. So God led the people around by the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up in orderly ranks and out of the land of Egypt. And it's awesome that Thomas read this about what he did about Joshua. Notice this. He actually read about Joshua. This is Joseph. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he had placed the children of Israel under solemn oath, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here with you. Joshua led them into those victories, so that they took their journey from Succoth and camped in Etham at the edge of the wilderness. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, so as to go by day and night. He did not take away the pillar of cloud by day or the pillar of fire by night from before the people. Father, I ask you in the name of Jesus to minister through your word this morning. We thank you for the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. And I thank you for each and every person that is here. And I pray, Lord, that our words will speak to their hearts, and you will let us now meditate and have our minds focused and our hearts ready to receive your word. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Last Sunday was an awesome day here in Sunday morning service as God ministered to people and set some people free. But you know, that only shows us and reconfirmed the fact that people are in need of deliverance. People are in need of deliverance. Not just within the church, but certainly outside the church, but also within the church. There are people that are even here today that are still bound by certain things. There are things that are causing you to stumble, things that are causing you to not have the success and the presence of God in your life like you want to. But I want to tell you, when you're delivered, when God delivers you, He leads you into His presence, and the cloud and the fire will be there with you. Then you can really enjoy God's presence. You see, when you're all bound up, it's hard to enjoy the presence of God because you're thinking about your problems. You're thinking about the thing that's got you bound. And of course, the devil's always trying to remind you of those things that's got you bound up and wound up tight and all this kind of stuff. But then once you are set free from that, once God delivers you from those things, then you can come into a worship service and you're just right there. I mean, the glory of the Lord will fall and you'll be right there to experience it. But I'm going to tell you this. Most of the time, if you don't enjoy worshiping God, and that almost sounds like an oxymoron. I mean, it just sounds crazy that there are people. But there are Christians that don't enjoy worship. They don't enjoy worship. They want to come in and hear the preacher preach. Why? I don't know. I really don't. They're not going to do what he says anyway if they don't enjoy worship. They're not going to be obedient to the scripture if they didn't enjoy worship. And I'm not talking about, it doesn't have to be our style of worship. It could be Southern gospel, whatever a person. I know there are churches that are thriving with a different style of music than what we do. That's not the point. It's not the point. It's the worship. It's the worship. But people, most of the time, the reason a lot of people don't enjoy worship is because they have bondage. There's things in their life that they haven't been set free from, and therefore when the presence of the Lord falls in a place, it makes them uncomfortable. And then when they become uncomfortable, rather than pointing at themselves, wow, look at that person. They're just in the flesh. They're, you know, that preacher up there dancing around, he's just doing that trying to get us all worked up. You know what? I never was a dancer when I was in high school. You can ask my wife, I've never danced. Don't go. I didn't go to dances. My high school didn't have dances. I didn't go to them. I didn't go to her prom. I didn't go to dances. You know why I didn't go to dances? Because my church said it was wrong to dance. Been there in this here church. They said, you don't go to dances. Yes, sir.
I want to know for a minute. You know, I've been looking for work. I just got a call. The voicemail, I went to check it because it was a new number. Mm-hmm. So I knew it was an older number, and I got an interview Wednesday morning. So it just happened.
Brother, I want to tell you what. I appreciate that question. People looking for jobs need to come to this church. I'm telling you, folks find jobs when they come here and we pray for them. And we didn't pray for you a job. Well, I have, because I've been talking and praying. But amen, that's awesome testimony. But I tell you, people get all wrapped up but on the dancing thing. That wasn't something that I did. And so now I just kind of enjoy it in the Holy Ghost. I really do. And it doesn't matter if anybody else likes it or not. I'm enjoying it. And that's why you got to be in church sometimes. But if there's always somebody, well, you know, that's... What are they doing that for? So what I'm saying this morning is simply this. You'll never enjoy the presence of God. You'll never enjoy worship. You'll never enjoy the manifest presence of God when He comes down and sits down in a place so thick that you could cut it with a knife. You'll never enjoy it until you've been set free.
Amen.
Until you've been set free. Are y'all cold? It was hot, now it's cold. Nobody, okay, don't leave it on. I want to tell you about it, and I've got people here that can verify this particular, what I'm about to tell you, about the glory of God, the manifest presence of God. And I probably shared this a time or two, but there's some of you that haven't heard it, and I need to share it with you. Back on June 1st, about 2003, somewhere in there, 2002, the reason I know the date is because that's my wife and I's anniversary. Well, I was on staff at Warrior Assembly of God at that time. Brother Danny was on staff, and many of us were going there. Every Monday night, there was a men's meeting. Men would come not only from Warrior Assembly, but other churches all over this countryside, and would gather there on Monday nights for prayer. Many times, 30, 35, 40 men go in there to pray on Monday nights. Well, on this particular Monday night, we were sitting there, and things, we were just kind of talking, and I got to feeling guilty because I was at the men's meeting rather than at home with my wife on our anniversary. So I told the pastor, I said, I think I'm going to slip out and go home and go back home and spend some time with Angela. The girls were there and everything. And he said, okay. Well, on the way home, we just lived a short distance from the church. We actually lived in Warrior at that time. We lived a short distance. And when I got home, or on the way home, the Lord told me, when you get home, call back to the church and tell the pastor and all those men to go out in the parking lot. That was dark. Go out in the parking lot. So I walked in the door and I told Angela, and she said, well, you better call him. So I called and told him, I said, I don't have a clue why, but the Lord told me to call you and tell you to have all the men go out in the parking lot. And he said, okay. So I told Angela, she said, well, you better go back and see what's going on. So I went back. Well, when I got there, they had already gathered out in the parking lot. You remember this night, Danny? And we gathered in a big circle out in the parking lot. You was there when we called. You was there when we got. Yeah. All right. Anybody, any other man that was there that was here? Randy was there. We began to stand in a circle, and we just began to pray and worship and sing. And a cloud, literal cloud, sat down in that parking lot. And it was nowhere else in Warrior but in that parking lot. A fog sat in that parking lot. Am I telling the truth, guys? Jack's crying. It was the most incredible thing. About the time that the cloud was there, the pastor's wife and another lady in the church dropped by. And Jason White was working at Piggly Wiggly, and he drove down Highway 31 going home, and he saw it. It was nowhere else. You say, oh, that was just a fog.
No.
There was no fog anywhere else in the city of Warrior, right on that parking lot. And I mean, the men just began to fall on their knees and worship, and the power of God was so present. And then as quick as it came, it was gone.
We also put our shoes off.
Yes, many pulled their shoes off, right? You're right. I've never seen it since, and I've never seen it before that night. I got chill bumps on my arms just thinking, remembering that. That was something that I will never forget, because God showed up where we can see Him. We just didn't feel Him, Brother Lee. We saw Him. The cloud. You say, well, the Bible says it was a fire by night. Well, the fire of the Holy Ghost was in that cloud, I promise you. It was powerful. Men were set free. Men's lives were forever changed because of that. When the presence of God fills His sanctuary, when His train fills the temple, as Isaiah 6 says, when He comes into this place in His manifest glory and His presence, you will fall on your knees and you will worship Him and you will fall in love with Jesus. But if you've got bondage in your life, you will be miserable and you'll be looking at your watch saying, I can't wait till this stops and we can hear the preaching because this is making me feel uncomfortable.
Yes.
If you felt uncomfortable this morning, oh, preacher, don't you dare go there. If you felt uncomfortable this morning, God has you right where He wants you. Because He's trying to show you. He's trying to pull it out of you. If you will just submit to Him, God's deliverance leads to His presence. Go to the next slide, Robbie. Point number one. I want to talk the game that Pharaoh played in this situation with the children of Israel. You go back to the story of Moses. You know the ten times that Moses went back to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said, go on. If you'll do this, I'll let you go. You do this, I'll let you go. And on, this game of mouse that Pharaoh played over and over and over and over again. Did you know this morning, this afternoon, that the devil is playing games with you?
That's right.
He is playing games with you. He made Moses think. Now listen, Pharaoh, symbolic of the devil, made Moses think that he was going to do what he said he would do. And Moses would go and do. And then what would Pharaoh do? Nah, I changed my mind. What kind of string does the devil have attached to you? Where's the hook? Those saying, boy, he must have something on him or he wouldn't be doing that. The old saying, you know, pulling around by the nose. Well, this game went on and on and on and on. And there would be a plague coming. And Pharaoh said, get him out of here, Moses, get him out of here. But you can't take your cattle. Nope, we're going to take everything. Then you can't leave. Just this game, this continuous, as this cat and mouse deal went on. Finally, the ultimate came. When Moses went back and said, if you don't let the people go, the death angel is going to come, and it's going to strike every firstborn in the land of Egypt. I mean, the frogs didn't get... If you woke up in your bed and it was filled with frogs, would that not have convinced you? Or locusts? The darkness? The blood and the water? On and on and on it went. The devil drives a hard bargain. He drives a hard bargain because he wants your soul.
Amen.
And if he can't get your soul because you've already accepted Jesus, then he wants to make you most miserable on this earth.
Amen. That's right.
He'll settle for making you miserable. He couldn't get Moses, but he sure was trying to make him miserable, wasn't he?
Yes.
And the Bible says that Pharaoh's heart would be hardened. The farther it went, the harder his heart got. Now, I want you to notice the parallel there. The longer you play the games with the devil, the longer you walk around in your bondage, the longer you play that bondage over in your mind, the longer you entertain that thought and that bondage, the harder your heart will grow. I didn't come to hear that this morning, preacher. Well, we don't want to play games with the devil. Pharaoh would seem to consent and let the people go, then change his mind. The plagues went on and on until the final plague killed all the firstborn. I want you to notice one of the devil plays games, but God doesn't.
That's right.
You hear me? The devil plays games, but God doesn't.
That's right.
God lays it out there. He said, here it is, take it or leave it. He doesn't push you to do anything. He doesn't push me to do anything. He lays it out there, says, here it is. I'll even give you the correct answer, he says.
Right.
Choose life.
Yeah.
Yes.
But he still leaves it to you. You see, God's not in the game plan business.
That's right.
That's the devil's territory and your territory and my territory. God just lays it out there. Now, what choice? Do you want to walk around in bondage or do you want to be set free? That's the very simple question. That's what God asked. The children of Israel needed to be set free, and it was a very simple decision for them to make, and Moses chose to lead the people out. He chose to choose. He chose God's way to lead those people out of bondage. And so when they made the choice, Pharaoh finally let them go. I want you to notice the second one, what God did. He led them through the wilderness. Now, the coastal highway was nearby, which would have made a whole lot more sense for the children of Israel to go the way of the coastal highway. But if they had gone the way of the coastal highway and passed the fortified cities and seen the armies of the Egyptians and seen all of this, the Word of God says they may have gotten afraid and turned around and went back. Sometimes when you see the battles, it makes you want to turn around and go back. Whoa. But how can you go back to what God has delivered you from?
Amen. Amen.
Who would want to go back to what God delivered you from? Why would you want to go back to what God delivered you from? But God knew that that was a possibility with the children of Israel. So he wouldn't allow them to go down the coastal highways where he would see their fortifications. And they was not to go back to the reproach of Egypt. The reproach of Egypt. They were not to go back to it. Just like you and I are not to go back to the reproach of our former lifestyle. We're not to go back to that. God has delivered us from that. He set us free from that. We're to walk in the abundant life, the new life, walking with Jesus on a daily basis, getting into His Word, worshiping Him, walking in the presence and power of God.
Amen.
So he said, you can't go down that coastal highway. I'm going to lead you into the wilderness. Oh, and they murmured and complained, and when they come to the Red Sea and said, you know, why have you led us to this place? The Egyptian army's behind us, the wilderness and deserts behind, around us, the Red Sea's in front of us. What are we going to do? You've led us out here just to be slaughtered and to be killed. Have you ever felt like that?
Yeah.
Honestly, some have. All of us at one time or another. But you see, Moses went back and prayed, and this is what God told Moses. He said, you will not have to lay one hand on your enemy. You won't have to fight him with a sword. You won't have to fight him with a spear, because I'm going to deliver you. And Moses went back and told the people, God said that he's going to deliver us and we won't even have to lift a finger. Some of them believed him and some of them, oh, you're just crazy, Moses. You know, you're just crazy. You're just crazy. And Moses lifted up his staff. And the Red Sea began to boil and stand up on end. And the ground, you know, you think about it. That's got to be muddy. That water's been there. They walked not on muddy ground. They walked on dry ground. He paved it for them.
He didn't just stand the water up on him. He made the mud dry up.
And of course, every time you preach on this nowadays, you've got to include this in there, because some scientists have said, well, the place where they crossed the Red Sea was only 7 inches deep. Yeah. Well, that makes the miracle twice as good, because the whole Egyptian army was drowned in 7 inches of water.
Come on now.
Either way, it's a miracle. It's a miracle either way you look at it. That scientist after something more than that, I think he wanted to retract his statement. Anyway, so you see, God delivered them. Then he gave them this promise. And I went back, but he gave them this promise. When Moses went to the people and told them they were leaving, he said, you will have a cloud by day, and you will have a fire by night, and I will never take it from you. And did you know? The entire time they marched and they was conquering the land, they had the cloud by day and the fire by night. Now, what was that cloud and what was that fire? It was the manifest presence, the glory of God. The glory of God surrounded the children of Israel. His glory settled upon them, just like it did in that parking lot back in 2003. Just like it was that night when the glory of God settled in that place. Just like the glory of God settles in this place from time to time. Just like His fire falls in this place and becomes like a fire shut up in our bones. And we gotta dance. I just gotta dance. I just gotta sing. I just gotta praise. I just gotta spin like a top. I just gotta do something foolish because I'm so excited in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit, and God wants that in restoration. Chris, I almost said first assembly of God. Because I'm Pastor A.G. Sloan. He wants to do that in RCF. He wants to settle in this place. He wants to settle in this place. The cloud wants to come and settle over your home. He wants your home to be under the power of the Holy Ghost, not just at church. He wants, when you get in your automobile to go to work, for that cloud to settle in there and you to worship. Dan talks about worshiping on his way to work. Many of you talk about worshiping on your way to work. Your car becomes a vehicle for the glory of God. And people might drive by and think your car's on fire. But that's okay. It's just the Holy Ghost in there. See, it gives you a great testimony. Somebody honking their horn and say, your car's on fire. And you say, he's got it. He's got it. I got it. It's just the glory of God. It's just the smoke of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. That's what God wants. You say, preacher, you just get too excited. I just can't stand it. I tell you, how can you not? How can you not want that? God provides deliverance through the glory. Once the deliverance comes, he settles in, and then you can enjoy his glory. You know, the children of Israel was afraid of that presence. And when Moses came down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments, they couldn't even look at him. They couldn't even look at him. Now, they had made their idol of gold, and they melted their earrings and all this kind of stuff, and they had made an idol. They couldn't look at the real because they was focused on the eye. Yeah. Most people can't look at the real in church because their eyes are on the eye. What is the eye? You tell me. Saw a video, need to get it someday. Saw a video. He said, this guy was speaking, he said, I saw this real weird religion. And these people painted their faces and had on masks. All this kind of stuff. And they gathered in this big place and they was doing chants and dances. And it showed natives in Africa. You've seen them. All that stuff. Headgear and all that stuff. And then the guy says, "Oh, but I don't believe you're understanding what I'm saying." He said, "Let me put it to you. Let me rewind." And the video rewinds, and he comes back in. He said, "I saw this religious cult, and these people had on masks, and they had painted their bodies, and they gathered in large places, and they were chanting and screaming." And so the football stadium. The fans with their faces painted, their bodies painted. Now, I'm not against sports, obviously. Because I wouldn't support a team that lost 17 in a row. Now let me say this. Did you know that you'll never be appreciative of the manifest presence and glory of God, the real, if your eyes are always on the false? You'll never be able to enjoy God's presence. There are people today that are so giddy because their team won that they can't even enjoy sitting in church to hear God's word because they're thinking about it. Or they're thinking about it. I'm not preaching against that, though. Understand what I'm saying here this morning. God's people need to appreciate God.
Amen.
God's people need to love God.
Amen.
God's people need to be focused on God.
Amen.
That's not to say these other things, you can't have these other things. God's got to come. The cloud by day, the fire by night, His glory, His presence, fill that place. Go to the next one, Robbie, and this will be. There are many deliverance of other examples in the Bible of God delivering people, and several of those. You think about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, thrown into the fiery furnace. But who showed up? There was a fourth man in the fire. A fourth man. The king looked in there and said, "Wait a minute, didn't you throw three in there? Well, who is this fourth man walking in the fire with them?" And when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego come out of the fiery furnace, they didn't even smell like smoke. Not even the hair on their arm had been singed. You ever been barbecuing and the flame up and burn the hair on your hand? Boy, it smells awful, doesn't it? They didn't even smell like that because the fourth man was in the fire. What was in the fire with them? The presence and power of the Holy Spirit. The second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ Himself, was in the fire with them. Yeah. And they was worshiping Jesus while they was in the flame.
That's right.
Daniel in the lion's den, thrown in there for praying. The lion's mouth was shut. Because God was not finished with Daniel and He delivered him from the mouth of the lion. You say, that's all in the Old Testament. Let's move over to the New Testament where we find Peter in jail asleep between two guards. And an angel comes in and says, "Peter, get up. Put on your clothes. Put on your shoes. We're going out of here." And his chains fell off and he walked out of that prison. Paul and Silas in prison. And an angel comes. An earthquake shakes the place. And the guards starting to kill themselves because they think that they've escaped. And Paul says, don't kill yourself. We're still here. God delivered them. What has God delivered you from? What does God need to deliver you from? What do you want God to deliver you from? So that you can enjoy His presence. You see, when you've got that presence walking with you, when you're walking in His presence, when you're walking in His glory, when His glory has settled upon you, there will be nothing impossible for you. There will be nothing impossible for you. All things are possible to him that believe God. Yea, all things are possible. Nothing is impossible.
Right.
God provided the Jordan River for Naaman to dip in 7 times and heal him of his leprosy. And the ultimate deliverance was God gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The ultimate deliverance, the deliverance from our sin by Jesus Christ dying on the cross.
Amen.
The ultimate deliverer. God's people deserve to lift up the name of Jesus. God needs his people to recognize his Son. That's why his life won't work. That's why Mormonism won't work. That's why Russellism or Jehovah's Witness won't work. It's because they deny the deity of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. And sadly, it's creeping into the mainline churches.
Yes. Amen. Yes. Oh, amen.
It's creeping into the mainline churches where Chris Long is being taught. That you can serve Christ and Islam.
Yes.
What a farce.
It's a lie from the pits of hell.
Straight from hell.
But it's deceiving people all over this nation.
God's people need deliverance. Deliverance needs to be in our churches.
The reason the power and presence of God can't go into some churches is because the people don't want it.
They're in bondage. They don't want to be set free. Some people enjoy the problems too much. They don't want to be like to be set free. They'd rather wallow in their problems.
Heard a story of a man that wanted to pray for his healing,
and he said, I don't want to be healed.
And the preacher said, why would you not want to be healed?
He said, because if I get healed, I got to work and my check will quit coming from the government.
That's true.
That's not just a made-up story.
No. It's true.
That's unreal.
Would you bow?
Father, I come to you in Jesus' name. And I thank you, Lord, for the power of your Spirit.
Thank you for your glory.
And I ask you, Lord, this morning that you will bless this word that has been spoken.